Yes, it is important for biosimilars to be properly named and identified, and it's good that this is the last talk, because everything we talked about, Professor de Klerk and myself, has always something to do that in the end you can identify as the prescriber what you give to your patient, because otherwise you cannot correlate all these factors of efficacy and safety in the end. And I really loved your example, Paul, with these switching studies. In the end, you really get totally mixed up by having, I don't know, 6-7 choices, and then you don't know what kind of adverse events belongs to the biosimilar compound. So naming of biosimilars, we have recommendations by the EMA and by the FDA, but in the end, it's good. Pharmacovigilance is important for detection of rare and unexpected safety issues, and we have to have unique names for a proper distinguishing of the different products. And this is really a challenge when you see what the current naming policy is over the last decades, and you see that the number of EPOs, for example, increased, and if you prescribe by ENN, by INN, then you have epoetin, 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 and you can distinguish this by epoetin theta, so a Greek letter, epoetin zeta, alpha, and so on. But then you have different epoetins alpha and different epoetins zeta, and then you get mixed up when you prescribe just an epoetin alpha for my patient. Therefore, if you have to report adverse events, then you have to know the brand name in the end, because prescription by ANN, if I, as a physician, write just down epoetin, then the pharmacist dispenses what is available and what is less expensive. And my hospital pharmacist will do this. But if I write down a brand name, then he is forced to communicate with me if it's not available, the compound I prescribed. Therefore, we as prescribers must be able to track accurately which particular biologic was given to a patient to allow, in the end, an adequate pharmacovigilance. I will skip this, and of course there are directives from different years, but all in all, the EMA guideline on pharmacovigilance practice for biological medicine from the year 2016 says we have to capture the brand name and the batch number. Brand name and batch number. This is what I told you already. And in a real-world scenario, and this is what I think is important, and this is a study from the Netherlands on traceability of biologics. Here, more than 1,588 ADR reports were analyzed, and overall, in just 76% of these ADR reports, the brand name was stated. And 93 of the 80 reports for opinions had a brand name, but 0 of the 80 reports had a batch number included. And when I think of my systemic treatment ward, we have a year around 5,500 cycles of chemotherapy in my department. No one writes down the batch number, and no one writes down the brand number, which is, we say, well, this is the INN. And now we have to change, really. And this is, I think, really hard to train, but in the end, we have to do this. There are different possibilities. One I figured out already, brand name plus INN plus the Greek letter, or brand name plus INN plus biosimilar and the number. For example, filgrastim, then you have filgrastim biosimilar number 3, number 4, and so on. And what the FDA recommended, the brand name and the INN, and then a four-letter suffix. And there's an example, saxofilgrastim, SNDZ, and this comes from Sandoz, but SNDZ doesn't say it comes from Sandoz, so this is by accident, and there's a discussion going on. Do we have to use four-letter suffixes that can more identify the product, or is it just by accident? These are different examples, and there you see adalimumab, for example, ATTO has nothing to do with the company, it's just by accident, and infliximab, A, B, D, A. So, well, maybe it's better to recommend to use these suffixes as, that has something to do with a company or makes it easier to identify. So this is a discussion that is going on, random not random, is this meaningful? Short conclusion, I will skip because I have told you already, and the labeling of biosimilars, we have different approaches, a generic approach, labeled to be an identical copy for the reference product, then we have an innovative product approach. This is the label to include information on the biosimilar, and then we have a combined and I think more transparent approach to combine information on both the biosimilar and the reference product. And this is an overview what kind of approaches are used in the US, in the EU, Health Canada, and so on. And in the EU, we have a generic approach, and that means that the label, and this is recommended by the EMA, has to include a biosimilar statement, but just a statement, and the rest, so the summary of the product characteristics belongs to the reference product. I think I have an example here. So this is one example for Remzima, for example. So the label is totally the same. And then in section 5.1, and there is written Remzima is a biosimilar medicinal product, details, information, and so on. But there's no information about the clinical data. So what kind of study was done? It's just biosimilar. And the data set that exists is from the reference product. And the data set we have for the biosimilar compound is just to show biosimilarity. And this is something that it's really strange to me, but this is the biosimilar word in the end, that we have to show biosimilar similarity, and therefore the label just includes one sentence, this is a biosimilar product. More transparent would be combined labeling approach, like in Canada, that we distinguish between data from the biosimilar and from the reference product regarding adverse reaction, regarding the data from clinical trials. So therefore, there's a bit more transparency, and for me as a physician who is interested in clinical data and, of course, in safety issues, it would be a better label than the generic approach that is done in the EU. Of course, stakeholders recommend that a combined, more transparent labeling approach is preferred. And this is another publication where a survey of 210 physicians across 7 different European countries were asked, what do you want, what do you prefer? And of course, a large majority preferred the modification of the label for biosimilars in terms of a combined approach to get more transparency. My last slide to summary and conclude, labeling approaches for biosimilar differ globally. The combined labeling approach is what I think more transparent in terms of the source of clinical data, extrapolation, safety profiles, what I'm interested in as a prescriber. The majority of stakeholders is the same opinion, and physicians would prefer to label what I said with a combined approach. And that's it. And yeah. Thanks for your attention.